mechanical way, reacting to external demands or instruction rather than in ways determined by his own interests and energies and power. He says we may admire what he does, but we despise what he is. For Humboldt, then, man is born to inquire and create. And when a man or a child chooses to inquire or create out of his own free choice, then he becomes, in his own terms, an artist rather than a tool of production or a well-trained parent.
Hello and welcome to the 25th episode of the Diet Soap Podcast, entitled, This Podcast is a Lie, or Paraconsistent Logic in You. This podcast is going out onto the inner tubes on September 30th, 2009. I'm Douglas Lane, the editor of the zine Diet Soap and the host of this podcast. This week's guest is a philosopher and fiction writer named Ben Burgis, and we'll be hearing from him in just a moment. But as always, I have some business to get out of the way at the beginning here, and it's mostly just reminding you that you can send me an email. That email address is douglane@dietsoap.org. You can also find me on Facebook under my name, Douglas Lane. I'm the one in Portland. And you can even go to my own webpage entitled simply douglaslane.com. I really like hearing from people who have listened to the podcast, and you can find a form to send me a message from my webpage. And even when people disagree with my choice for a guest or a topic, I actually like hearing the feedback. This week, I want to thank Josh B. for communicating his concerns about Lynn Bracken and the 9/11 Truth Movement. Josh didn't convince me or ultimately bring me around to his perspective, but I appreciated his time and engagement on the subject, and Josh found me on Facebook. I also want to thank Terry I., who wrote to thank me for doing the podcast and to suggest a guest. Terry is a dairy farmer in Virginia and a regular correspondent now. This week, you'll be hearing an interview I did with Ben Burgis, who is a philosophy graduate student, writing his dissertation on the subject of paraconsistent logic, and who is also a writer and a contributor to the Diet Soap website. You'll also be hearing Ben's story, Sing, Goddess, Sing Me to the Stars, after the interview. The story has been considerably condensed for this podcast, but if you'd like to read it in its entirety, you can find the story, Sing, Goddess, Sing Me to the Stars, in the 8th issue of the zine Flytrap, which I understand is now defunct, but which is still selling back issues. And I will put a link in the show notes. But now, without any further ado, let's hear that interview with Ben Burgis, Philosopher King. Ben Burgis, you are an MFA student in the creative writing program at the University of Southern Maine. You enjoy long walks on the beach, dropping acid, and rereading your collection of Philip K. Dick novels. Your story, Three Perspectives on the Role of the Anarchists in the Zombie Apocalypse, won the second place prize at Tales of the Zombie War, and your story, The True Meaning of K-Day, appeared on Diet Soap. Ben's day job is either playing piano at a Chinese brothel and opium den, or being a TA in the philosophy department at the University of Miami and an adjunct instructor at Miami-Dade College. No one knows which.
Yeah, that sounds pretty complete. Although additional data has come in, I am in fact a graduate student at Miami, and I in no way have any sort of job playing piano at a Chinese brothel or opium den.
Oh, no, really?
Yeah.
Can you play the piano at all?
I took lessons when I was a kid.
Okay. All right. Well,
yeah.
When I put up a call on my, I think it was my Facebook, for people to recommend living philosophers, and your name popped up. It was too good to resist. Because I had published your work at Diet Soap, I just figured that I had to have you on the show as one of today's prominent living philosophers. And it turns out that you are a philosopher of logic. Is that right?
Well, what my dissertation is about is philosophy of logic, specifically that dialetheism and paraconsistent logic. So dialetheism is the position that some contradictions might actually be true, that the liar sentence, this sentence is not true, since if it's true, it's not true, if it's not true, it is true, if it's neither true nor false, it's not true, so it is true. And so you might want to just bite the bullet and say it really is true and not true. That's what dialetheism is. Paraconsistent logic is any system of logic where not everything follows from inconsistencies. Since if you ever took an introductory symbolic logic class in college, what you learned there would be classical logic. And in classical logic, from any contradiction, anything follows, which is really weird if you start to think about it, is that means that if, for example, P is the liar sentence is not is true, right? So P and not P would be the liar sentence is true and the liar sentence is not true. It follows from that that, say, Q, where Q is the sky is green or Hitler won World War II. And that seems horribly counterintuitive, right? I mean, there are reasons why it's set up that way, but, you know, there are also reasons why we might want to revise logic to rein in those inferences, because it seems like not everything really follows from every contradiction.
Well, I want to take a step back here and ask you to reiterate the first two terms that you used. And so do that and a little more slowly so we can kind of get the ground beneath our feet here a little bit.
So paraconsistent logic, that's paraconsistent, like paranormal. So that just means any system of logic where it's no longer true that anything and everything follows from a contradiction. So that's the second term. The first term was dialetheism, which comes from the Greek word di, like two, and then alethic, like truth, which is the position that a single sentence can have both of the truth values, true and false. There are a lot of arguments for dialetheism, but the main ones have to do with these classic paradoxes that the sentence is not true and things like that. And if you're a dialetheist, then the logic that you reason with had better be a paraconsistent one, because if it's not paraconsistent, right, paraconsistent just means not everything follows from contradiction. So the logic that you're reasoning with isn't a paraconsistent one, right? It's one where everything does follow from a contradiction. That means that from certain paradoxical sentences being true and not true or other things like this, you get any result whatsoever, like without exception.
Okay. Well, let me just jump in there for a second. So my understanding of this is that the paraconsistent logic is basically a new system of logic or a modified system of logic that will allow you to hold that one sentence has two truth values at the same time. And I just remember, I majored in philosophy as an undergraduate and didn't go on from there. Well, I remember about the logic course that I took way back when I was in my teens. It was that I got very drunk on tequila the night before the exam, and that in the morning I had not been a good student, and in the morning before the exam I tried to just read the entire, you know, because I couldn't sleep. I had woken up, and I thought, well, now's my time. You know, it's 2 or 3 in the morning or 4 in the morning or whatever. And it was a lot like math, I discovered. I went on from there to major in philosophy and get a degree from Portland State without ever really taking a logic class that I remember passing. So you have to bear with me here. I fancy myself someone who can deal with philosophical concepts, but when it comes to the foundation of philosophy, logic, I'm actually fairly weak. I don't know if that's common for philosophy students in the undergraduate department or not.
Well, I think it's pretty common for a lot of people with PhDs in philosophy. You know, I mean, it's the sort of thing that if it's not what you do, you're as likely as not to sort of feel a little bit at sea or have kind of a little bit of a what-the-hell-is-that reaction. which is understandable.
But you use logic all the time when you're in philosophy classes, right? I mean, you're at least on some level you're using logic when you determine whether or not the idea of Platonic forms has any value.
Sure, I mean that's certainly true. I mean, look, I mean one way of thinking about this is you're certainly reasoning, you're acting as if there were good arguments and bad arguments, and you know arguments that deserve to be taken seriously and ones that don't. You're going from premises to conclusions, and presumably what we should want in a system of formal logic is something that kind of codifies our intuitions about which inferences from premises to conclusions seem like good ones, right? You know, that sorting out good from bad reasoning. And so one interesting way to think about all this is to look at what we're actually doing a lot of times when we're engaging in arguments about other areas of philosophy, because it strikes me that we are quite frequently in a position where if you have position A on some issue, you think position B not only happens to be false, but like couldn't be right. It's impossible. There's some way that like you could, if you really thought position B through, so you think there's something inconsistent or ridiculous about it, right? So that's frequently in any debate between deeply held views, that's something that's going to happen all the time. But at the same time, when you're arguing against that view, one of the ways that you argue against it typically is you draw out unacceptable conclusions from it, right? You say, well, if that were true, then such and such would be true, right? But it seems like when we're doing that, we act as if some things followed from these impossibilities and some didn't, which itself kind of suggests that our normal reasoning practice, even when we do academic philosophy, doesn't really reflect orthodox logic, right? Because, you know, we act as if these, at the same time, something's impossible. It couldn't be true, but that said, we can derive certain things from it, and we can't derive other things from it, and some arguments from it are good, and some arguments from it are bad, which suggests that we really don't act like everything follows from an inconsistency.
So this kind of logic, then, is trying to get formal logic more in line with the way people actually reason?
Yeah, I think so. Well, certainly at least the sort of reasoning that we typically take as good, right? I mean, obviously people frequently reason badly and they make conclusions that don't really follow from the premises and are convinced by unconvincing things. Still, we seem to have some kind of intuitive grasp of what counts as good inferences and what don't. And presumably, if we didn't, right, I mean, where would we get classical logic from in the first place, except from that? Here's what I think is a perfect example. I'm an atheist. I think that both of the following arguments are, like, excellent arguments against the existence of God, at least the existence of God in the traditional sense that's all-powerful and all-knowing and all that stuff, which are these, right? First argument is that the idea of being all-powerful seems to be self-contradictory, right? There's the stone paradox, right? You know, could God create a stone so heavy himself could not lift it? Or in my favorite formulation, the Simpsons version of it, Homer asked Ned Flanders if Jesus could microwave a burrito so hot that he himself could not eat it. And so that seems like a really good argument to me. Another really good argument seems like the argument from the problem of evil, right? That they have, that all of these horrible things happen. If God is all good, he'd want to prevent them. If God is all knowing, he'd know about them. I can't claim like a good German to be unaware of what's going on. And if he's all powerful, he could stop them, right? And I could send lightning bolts down to the tracks, lean dashets or whatever. So it seems like given that that doesn't happen, right, that this sort of gratuitous evil does exist, that seems like an excellent reason to believe that there isn't any kind of entity out there who's all good and all powerful and so on and so forth. Neither of these arguments are at all original, right? They're both very, very well-established arguments. I think a lot of my friends who are a lot less enthusiastic about the weird logic stuff than I am would agree that these are both good arguments. But notice that if we think that the argument from evil is a good argument, right, despite the fact that we think that the very idea that there could be an all-powerful being is inconsistent, we're acting as if there are some things that follow from this inconsistent idea and some things that don't, right? That if God existed, the various sorts of evil wouldn't occur, the Holocaust wouldn't have happened, whatever, seems like a good inference, whereas if God existed, X, for like any X wouldn't necessarily be a good inference.
If God existed, bunnies would be 10 feet tall. That doesn't follow. It doesn't seem to follow, although under formal logic it would.
Yeah, under at least, you know, classical assumptions about it, yeah, they have a... And there are more and less radical proposals for how you could go about tinkering with it to rein in those inferences, but at least to me it seems overwhelmingly clear that it's good to do so, right? Because if the point of doing formal logic isn't, you know, as another form of a math-like class to, you know, inflict on the tequila-addled brains of undergraduates, but, you know, you're actually trying to codify things and learn things about what good reasoning is and isn't, that it seems like this is the kind of thing you should pay attention to and make some kind of adjustments for.
Okay, so is this now I'm going to start calling it parapolitical logic or paralogic. Right. What is it called again? Paraconsistent, right? Yeah. Is this system of logic largely different from classical logic, or is that the primary difference?
Paraconsistent logic is a type, not a proper name, right? There are a bunch of different paraconsistent logics, right? A paraconsistent logic is just any logic in which it's not true that you can't derive anything from a contradiction. That's what it means. Or possibly we might want to say any like modern symbolic logic where you can't derive anything from a contradiction. Because interestingly enough, what we call classical logic is a couple of centuries old, and the older Aristotelian logic, right, the categorical syllogisms, you know, all men are mortal, Socrates is a man, that stuff, is technically, on the definition that I just gave, sort of paraconsistent, right? Because not all syllogisms with inconsistent premises deliver their conclusions. In Aristotelian categorical syllogistic logic, you can't say all cats are not dogs, some cats are dogs, therefore all pumpkins are 100 feet tall, right? I mean, that doesn't follow, right?
Alabama with my banjo on my knee. I'm going to Louisiana, my true love for to see. It rained all night the day I left, the weather it was dry. The sun so hot I froze to death. Susanna, don't you cry. Oh, Susanna, don't you cry for me. I come from Alabama with my banjo on my knee. I had a dream the other night when everything was still. I dreamed I saw Susanna coming down the hill. A red, red rose was in her cheek, a tear was in her eye. I said to her, Susanna gal, Susanna, don't you cry. Oh, Susanna, don't you cry for me. I come from Alabama with my banjo on my knee. Oh, Susanna, don't you cry for me. I come from Alabama with my banjo on my knee.
When you started talking again about the kind of premise that can just spring from a contradiction, like all pumpkins are 100 feet tall, it made me want to move into some of these things that I had written down before I called you, because I tend to write down some questions. I would just ask you, as someone who's a logician, how you respond to the Surrealist Project. People like James Gleason and André Breton, who want to get out from under the reign of logic. Do you feel that that has any social function at all, or is it just the blathering of silly artists?
I'm not going to call
on you. Let me give you a quote.
Sure.
Today, reason rules almost as much by force as by habit. At this moment, while we are at war against the totalitarian ideologies, we yet permit the more repressive dictatorship of reason over our minds. It is a tribute to the efficiency of this policemanship that we may look upon this planet and see how utterly Christ has failed. That's James Gleason, the surrealist who died last year. He's a painter.
Well, I like the surrealists, and that's certainly a very stirring quote, but as far as the underlying thought there, seems to me that if you want to change the world, right? I mean, that's the underlying motivation going on there. It seems to me in that quote that sense of dissatisfaction with the ruling powers and ideologies of the world. So if you're engaged in the serious business of trying to change the world, you have to start by at least getting a clear look at the way it actually is, right? You want to know what the world is actually like so you have a clear sense of what the openings are, what the possibilities are for changing it. And it seems like for having what I call good reasoning is just reasoning that gets us closer to the truth about how things actually are, right? I mean, like, they have just to bring it down to earth. If you believe in things on the basis of, like, double-blind empirical studies seems to be a better way, a more reliable way of figuring out how things actually are than believing things on the basis of anecdotal reports for how friends interpret their own experiences, believing things on the basis of arguments where there seems to be some connection between the premises and the conclusion seems to be a more reliable way of finding out how things are than just believing things randomly or because they make you feel good or because it would be cool if they were true. So I'd say that, you know, we could argue about what counts as good reasoning, but...
You don't want to throw reason overboard, then. You're not ready to do that in the name of some sort of surrealist revolution. I can't convince you of that. What if I contradict myself? That would be a logical conclusion, then. If I said a contradictory statement, then then that would follow that we should throw reason overboard, right? There is a little bit more to this idea of overthrowing reason, and I think it has to do with what the source of logic is. And then, for me, I want to walk from surrealism to this problem of a priori truths and empirical truths and the problem of perception. I want to say, okay, the surrealists were interested in and influenced by Sigmund Freud, and Sigmund Freud's premise, and, you know, from the point of view of logic, just kind of throwing all the other stuff out, is that human minds are unconsciously motivated and that what seems to be reasonable may not be because there are factors at work which we can't know about. Okay, and so the André Breton's of the world were actually trying to get at those factors and in a sense to understand how the mind worked in order to see past what is taken to be real and be able to see what is actually real. So they're overcoming everyday reason, but I don't think they're really overcoming reason with a capital R. But it also seems to me to have a bit of idealism to it, that there's something that you can understand by looking inward to the mind. I want to then say logic is based on this idea that there's something innate in language, right? There's a priori truths which you don't have to go out into the world to discover, like that all bachelors are unmarried men. You don't have to go out and ask every bachelor if he's married or not. So you want to be an empiricist as well as a logician and get beyond innate truths. Now, make heads or tails of all of that mishmash I put forward, if you would.
Okay, sure thing. So let's start with Freud and the underlying mechanisms behind, you know, we think things for some reason, and maybe we have some logical theory that captures that, but we really think them for some other reason. So we shouldn't bother with logic. We should bother with the real underlying mechanisms. And I'd say about that I'd just make a distinction between the reasons why we actually do come to conclusions and the reasons on the basis of which we should come to conclusions, right? I mean, that's certainly true that, and I just say that the should there would just be a should of, like, well, if you want to be right, right? I mean, if you want to get closer to the actual truth of the matter, right, this is what you should do. And I'd say that it's certainly true that, you know, there's all kinds of interesting stuff to be worried about the reason that we actually do come to the conclusions that we do, and oftentimes those are are mechanisms that we're not aware of, and there are all sorts of extra factors going on, and I wouldn't really dispute anything in that story, except for the implied normative conclusion that, well, that's the way we actually do reason, therefore it's the way that we should, right? I mean, that seems to me that oftentimes we have natural inclinations to reason very badly in ways that will lead us horribly astray, right? And so I'd say that it's definitely a useful project to do that sort of psychological research and, you know, see the ways in which people actually do reason, but it's also an even more useful project to think hard about whether the ways that we actually do reason deep down are ways that get us closer to the truth or further away from it. So, you know, I mean, there's tremendous evidence that, for example, human beings in general have a horrible tendency towards hasty generalization, right? Taking a sample size of like one and concluding something about the entire type, that they have this X is a Y, therefore all X's are Y's, right? And that might, you know, and that might serve an evolutionary purpose, actually, you know, because in terms of quickly adapting to new predators and, you know, prey and things like that, that might actually be something that serves us well. But if we're interested in other projects now, it might serve us very badly because, you know, it's usually not a good inference, right? It's usually not something that follows. So going from that to the stuff about empiricism, so this came up because when we were talking over Facebook before the interview, you said something about rationalism, and you quoted a definition of rationalism about, you know, how reason can be a source of information about the world or something like that. And on that level, I sort of agree, right? But I think that it depends, you know, what you think this reasoning consists of, right? I mean, it seems like I'm very suspicious of claims that there's such a thing as, like, pure reason as, like, some sort of extra faculty of, you know, perception about the world whereby we find out new information. It seems like it's very close to the truth that everything that we find out is ultimately derived from experience. And I'd even say that there's a sense in which even what we think about, like, the laws of logic are and things like that are in some sense ultimately derived from generalizing about our experience of the world, or at the very least, that if we're going to be justified in believing those things, then they have to be checked against the world. So in terms of thinking about how that works, I mentioned Klein earlier, and he talks a lot about confirmational holism, which is the idea that all of our beliefs face the tribunal of empirical evidence together. So, you know, for example, if you think about ways in which you might think a simple scientific prediction is falsified by something, right? You know, you have a theory of astronomy that says that such and such planet will be in such and such position at such and such a time, and then it isn't, and so you falsified that. But, you know, wait a second, think about how many other theories are at stake in that inference. If nothing else, it's our theory about optics and how telescopes work, and there might also be some purely logical assumptions built in there, too. And ultimately, everything's fair game for possible revision, I'd say, on the basis of contrary evidence. That even sort of purely logical and metaphysical assumptions are ultimately part of a package of beliefs that we're constantly testing against the evidence that we get from the external world, and that's really the only way we could ever find out about anything, ultimately, right?
Well, I mean, this. And when I took philosophy classes at college, that and what I learned was that the whole idea of an a priori truth or an innate truth was that it could not be disproven empirically. It was not a synthetic truth, but an analytic truth, that you could tell that all bachelors were unmarried men. Even if you went into the world and found a man who was married, there would be no contradiction, and that you could tell that if all men are mortal and Socrates is a man, then Socrates is mortal. You could tell that was true without having to wait around for Socrates to die.
Sure. So, and this is the nub of it, right? I don't accept the analytic synthetic distinction. I don't think there are any analytic truths. I think that, of course, as a pragmatic issue, there are some things that are worth really going out and checking all the time, and there's some things that aren't. But then again, we don't need to bring in analyticity for that, right? We can just say, you know, even for purely scientific truths that everybody would think are synthetic, right? Nothing travels faster than the speed of light. We don't have to go around trying to see if we can drive faster than the speed of light and seeing if we can propel different objects faster than the speed of light all the time, right? So, but I don't think that there are analytic truths. I think that, for one thing, I think that the historical record should give us pause here, because there are certainly things that people used to put in the analytic category that we now say are not only non-analytic, they're not true, right? Like they have there's one and only one shortest path between any two points, right? From Euclidean geometry, 300 years ago, I doubt anybody would have denied that was analytic. That was something that you could tell just from thinking about it. It wasn't made true by the way the world is. It was just true, right? Now we learn from Einstein and the non-Euclidean curve of space-time that it's actually not true, right? There are lots of different shortest paths between two points in space-time. So that sort of example is one reason why I'm suspicious of that kind of distinction. But on a more general level, I'd say with this conformational holist picture, that all of our beliefs are part of a package, and the package is collectively tested against the way the world is, right? When we have contrary evidence, that's contrary evidence against the whole package of beliefs, and you can revise the package in any way that you want, and, you know, and it seems, according to certain requirements about making sure that you have the simplest explanation, it's non-ad hoc, and it's, you know, satisfying, and it has predictive power, and all that stuff. And I think that sometimes that might involve rejecting purely logical assumptions. This isn't really my area, but there's something called quantum logic, which is a view, you know, which is alternative, the name for alternate systems of logic, in which the distributive law, which says that from A and B or C, it follows that either A and B or A and C fail because of some results in quantum mechanics. And we can have an argument about whether that's too hasty or not, but there seems to be. But, you know, people who argue for this say, look, if we get rid of this logic with this one fairly obscure logical law, there are all these really weird things about quantum mechanics that stop being quite so weird, or we seem to have a better grasp on what's going on there, and the evidence might favor that, and that might be, you know, part of a better overall package of beliefs. And that doesn't seem completely crazy to me, right? That seems like something that you'd have to be very careful about evaluating on a case-by-case basis, but I don't see why not in principle. Greg Egan actually has a talks about that in the introduction to his short story collection, whose name I don't actually remember right off the top of my head, but Egan gets the details wrong, but he does at least mention this in the introduction, which made me happy when I read it.
Well, I'll find out what that book is and put it in the show notes and maybe mention it, you know, when I'm editing this together. But just going back a step to your example of the shortest distance between two points, not being just one, it strikes me that you could still say that on a two-dimensional plane, that the shortest distance between two points there's only one shortest distance between two points, and that would be an a priori truth. You wouldn't have to get pieces of paper and keep drawing. And that alternative theory, which states that there's more than one, there's many, is basically a different. It's not taking place on a two-dimensional plane. It's taking place in a, five- or six-dimensional universe or a different kind of structure that if you could wrap your mind around that structure, you might be able to, without testing it empirically, come to the conclusion that there being more than one shortest distance followed logically and innately.
Sure, and that's the usual move by people who believe in analytic truths, right? When you've been proven wrong, reinterpret the claim so it's relative to some other factor, and, you know, and in that new context, it seems okay again, and that's fine. You know, you can do that if you want to, and There might be.
Well, I think you have to show why that's a move that doesn't follow. I mean, I think that. Am I making a mistake there?
I think that if you're making a mistake, you're in very good company. Like, I think that lots of people whose views I respect a lot say exactly the same thing at that point. Right. So I think that's fine. I think that I would point out that I seriously doubt that anybody pre Einstein thought that it was only certain that there was one shortest path between the two points on a two-dimensional plane. I think that they thought that, well, it's only, you know, it's certain that there's only one shortest point between path between two points. I mean, sort of think by analogy, if you had something like basic arithmetic was shown to be proven wrong for our world in some way, right? It turned out that it wasn't true that 2 + 3 = 5 in this reality. And there are parallel moves that you could make, of course, at that point by saying, well, whatever factor it is about our world that makes that not true, 2 + 3 = 5, we can isolate that factor and say that, well, and sure, in this world, like in worlds that are y that way, 2 + 3 doesn't equal 5, but 2 + 3 still equals 5 relative to whatever that factor is. And that's fine, and you can do that, and that's a perfectly respectable move, but I still think that there's been something, there would in that scenario be something that's been fundamentally shaken that we all thought we were could be completely certain of, right, in advance of the evidence.
No, I can definitely see that, and I feel like at this point, if I were to try to continue, that I would have to sit down and think about it and like write a dissertation or at least a paper to try to make the argument, and at which point I'd be engaging in philosophy and, ooh, yuck. Do you have anything else you want to close out with? I feel like we should wrap this up. I'll probably edit this together and put it out in August sometime or probably August. So predict the future and talk about something topical as you close out. How about that?
Sure. Well, as you know, Doug, since we're having this conversation in August 2009, the Earth was invaded by aliens in July 2009, and I personally am against it. There were downsides to the brief period in which the working class had political power back in July.
Well, when they dragged off my wife and shot her, I was a little upset, but
otherwise. Yeah, I mean, to be fair, because I did authorize that, her name was very similar to somebody on the list. It's an easy mistake. It could have happened to anyone. And it did send you that gift back.
Right, well, thank you, comrade. Or I should say, with me, it says now that the aliens are in charge. All right, well, I think that will all be cut.
Emmanuel Kant was a real piss and he was very rarely stable. Heidegger was a boozy beggar who could think you under the table. David Hume could have consumed Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel. And Wittgenstein was a beery swine who was just a schlosh to Schlegel. There's nothing Nietzsche couldn't teach about the raising of the wrist. Socrates himself was permanently pissed. John Stuart Mill of his own free will on half a shandy was particularly ill. Later they say he could sing it away. Half a grain of whiskey every day. Aristotle was a bugger for the bottle. Hobbes was fond of his dram. And René Descartes was a drunken fart. I drink, therefore I am. Yes, Socrates himself is particularly missed. A lovely little thinker but a bugger when he's pissed.
Sing, Goddess, Sing Me to the Stars by Ben Burgis. There are lizards in my coffee and I won't drink it. There are lizards everywhere on this planet. Little green fuckers with floppy tails and tiny yellow eyes. Some days this entire war with its armies of spiders, humans, and bumpies seems like a diversion. A footnote to the real war we're fighting against this planet. With this irradiated sand that gets trapped in your throat. Its winds that blow all day and all night. And all of its goddamn little lizards. Lizards invade my dreams. Even my dreams of Earth. I'll be standing there after I get my discharge, holding my one little suitcase. Ginny will be there, even though in real life she dumped me when I was drafted. We'll kiss, and then we'll go into her apartment, and there will be lizards there too, and nothing's changed, not a goddamn thing, because I'm not back on Earth at all. Jack and Malloy, they just drink their coffee down. Lizards are no lizards. The trick is to keep your teeth almost closed while you're gulping it. Sometimes doing it that way, you kiss the lizard, but you don't actually swallow it. I shake my head and push the cup away. You're lost, Johnny boy. Jack leans back into his rickety plastic chair, rubbing his stubble and looking all philosophical. Bottom line, though, you're here. You might as well roll with it. My enlistment's up soon. Jack snorts, not even bothering to remind me that my enlistment's been up 3 times already. Every time I get a temporary emergency extension. Another 6 months, another year. Hell, I think Jack's enlistment's been up 4 or 5 times. The spiders call the shots, and they're not in any hurry to let us go. The spiders rolled through Sweet Home Terra when I was in the 10th grade. After that, the generals moved into the White House and made their peace with the spiders. We got to keep the flag and have full sovereignty. In return, the spiders get to appoint the president and the heads of industry. They get our whole economy reoriented toward producing raw materials for factories on the spider home world. Best of all, they get us, lots and lots of dumb little human boys, to fight in the spiders' long war against the bumpies. I'm all suited up now, the best protection that human and spider technology can provide without the army wasting a lot of money on replaceable grunts. In other words, I've got a plastic mask, some flimsy goggles, and a protection suit that looks like a red wetsuit. This suit is the only part of the package that represents an actual technological advance on anything the army used 20 years ago during the invasion of Iraq. Move out! We're running now, 3 to a row, across the rocky red ground. The wind is blowing reddish-orange sand everywhere, but with practice you can see shapes through it pretty well. A spider runs behind us. The spider is the CFEO, the Coalition Friendship Enforcement Officer. It clutches a heat stick in one of its mouths, aimed at our moving backs. The first few bumpies of the morning skirmish appear through the drifting sand. They're still a considerable distance away. They run 3 to a row, like us. I'm sure that's why the spiders use us as soldiers, so they can engage bumpies with creatures that can fight like bumpies. Bumpies even kind of look like us, in their broadest outline. 2 arms, 2 legs, between 5 and 8 feet tall. The spiders, though, the spiders don't look like anything. I mean, they're black, and they walk around on 8 legs. That's why we call them spiders. But that's the extent of the similarity between them and anything as banal as a real spider, like we have back on Earth. People say spiders are as weird on the inside as they are on the outside. I've even heard some guys say that spider legs can be mashed into a powder, and it's like acid or mushroom or something. But I don't know how anyone ever had a chance to find out. The CFEO lumbers into view a few meters away, with a long heat stick in one of its mouths. It points it at us and uses it to gesture meaningfully, first at the 3 of us and then at the tunnel entrance. We don't need sophisticated translation gear to catch its meaning. It's time to go down into the valley. Once we're down there, the 3 of us cluster behind a rock. The valley is crawling with bumpies. There's a white flash and a boom, way too close. I fall down, smashed to the valley floor. The rock we've been hiding behind has been reduced to teeny little bits of rock drifting through the sandy air. John, there! Jack gestures with his heat stick towards the entrance to the tunnel. That seems like a spectacularly good idea right now. Malloy must think so too, because he's charging into that hole so fast he doesn't hear the hissing remonstrations of the CFEO. Mike screams, but the back of his protection suit is holding against the laser from the CFEO's heat stick. Thank God for small miracles. The sand just cleared up enough for me to get a clear shot. I don't have time to think. I aim my heat stick at the CFEO and fire. Holy God, I've just committed an act of mutiny. Not that I'm going to be strung up for this, mind you. If the CFEO dies, No one will know what happened. If it lives, it'll kill us on the spot without all the red tape. Jack's committing mutiny too. His eyes look hard and empty behind his goggles. The laser beam from his heat stick mingles with mine for a second in the spider's midsection. Thank God. One beam wouldn't get it done, but two together and a little dumb luck. Yep, there are spider bits drifting in the air. The bumpies just stand there without interfering. I guess it's the first time they've seen enemy soldiers killing each other instead of them in the middle of a battle. It must be a nice change. But orders are orders, and I suspect the bumpy officers won't be inclined to let us go just because of that little display of temporary insanity. No time to waste. We don't stop running until we're back at the base. After dinner, we find a secluded spot in the bunk area. Jack has something to show us. I got some, he announces, and pulls out a napkin. There's something black inside, maybe 4 or 5 inches long. Oh my God. Malloy figures out what it is before I do. Those innocent-looking green eyes of his look bigger than ever. Is that from the CFEO? Jack nods. He looks positively gleeful. I've always wanted to try this shit. He grinds it up with the flat end of his knife. We snort it. 15 minutes pass. Malloy. I don't think it's working. Jack. Give it time. Me. I knew this was a myth. Another 15 minutes pass. Malloy lies on the bed. Two lizards crawl over his body. He doesn't even swat them off. He mumbles to himself and laughs. Jack is foaming white stuff around his upper lip. It smells like baking soda. How do you get that from spider powder? From little spider legs, itsy-bitsy spiders up the waterspout. Itsy-bitsy spider? I am a spider. Naturally, what else would I be? I don't have 8 legs like I should. I've only got 2. 8 minus 2 is 6. Where are my other 6 legs? I'm a Coalition Friendship Enforcement Officer. This is a high point of my career. In the Spider Army, I could have been a simple soldier, but in the Army of the Manlings, I'm an important figure, an officer. My mother is proud, I'm sure. Perhaps one day I will go home and be granted land on the homeworld to spawn a mess of little spiderlings. I'm a spider, and I am many other spiders too. I retain the memories of the CFEO's parents and of their parents. I do not sample very many of these memories, but I am warmed by their presence in my mind. I am one being with these ancestors, and it is wonderful. I am a spider, naturally. I am a human, naturally. I am me, I am, and I play among the stars. I'm lying against the wall by the urinal as the stuff wears off. A lizard scurries across the floor. The room smells like piss and lizards and a little bit like blood. I shake my head. How much time has gone by? My hands are tingling. My brain is still warm with remembered bits and shreds of vision, drifting around in there like the sand out on the planet's surface, like the calling card of a half-forgotten god. I wander back to our hiding place in the back of the bunk area, carefully avoiding the lizards that dart back and forth across the floor. I turn the corner and see a bunch of officers standing around and talking to some enlisted men. Malloy is one of them. I open my mouth to call to him from across the room. He shakes his head, just slightly, and the look in those big green eyes of his tells me everything. Battle after battle, fighting side by side, we've had enough practice reading each other's eyes, even through goggles and blowing sand, that Malloy's meaning is instantly clear. He's saying, "Get the hell out of here." And I do.
I wonder if you're familiar with the Diet Soap podcast.
No, I'm not. Tell me about it.
Well, it is a podcast which was in part inspired by the Sea Realm podcast. And the host, Doug Lane, he says that he thinks of his podcast as part of an ongoing conversation that takes place in a public space between the various podcasters. And he frequently puts together montages from different podcasts to sort of show how there are certain themes that are circulating through all of them, even though, you know, we're not necessarily doing it deliberately or consciously.
Well, that's really fascinating. What's it called again?
Diet Soap.
Don't you want devoted followers who leave their families for you, give their money to you, give their bodies to you, give up their lives for you, consider you God, and will kill for you?
I love you.
Since the death of God, there's been a vacancy open. You could fill that void. Here's how.
Here are Wired's suggestions for optimal media health.
And I can see just the stats on some of my other sites that almost 60 to 75% of my hits are being generated by people coming from Facebook. So that's pretty awesome. So
here are Wired's suggestions for optimal media health.
It's just like, what do we do to make time? You know, when I was a kid, I said, and this was before I inherited my fortune, but it was probably not before I knew that I was going to, but still, I was quite young, I was about 11 or something, and I said that time is worth more than money because you can always make money.
Here are Wired's suggestions for optimal media health.
Electrode things are all over his body, giving him signals from the hands and so on, and he has a panel in front of him with buttons and dials and things, and so he more or less controls the body, but he isn't the same as the body, because I am in charge of what are called the voluntary actions, and what are called involuntary actions of the body, they happen to me. I am pushed around by them, but to some extent also I can push my body around.
Here are Wired's suggestions for optimal media health.
And it's a very, I think, compelling idea that we have an ability to reach out and to receive companionship and help when we need it.
Well, now, one thing occurs to me in thinking about this. There are the stresses on an individual from extreme conditions or from hard work or all the kinds of examples that you've given. But what about more abstract kind of stresses in today's world, concerns about the environment and global warming or things like that, where people, I think to a very large extent, feel that events are moving out of control and that whatever institutional apparatuses, what's the plural of apparatus, that whatever institutional apparatus we have is insufficient to cope with these perhaps existential challenges to ourselves.
Yeah, I haven't found evidence that, you know, those sorts of questions can lead to this experience. What I've found is that it's usually a highly personal.
Here are Wired's suggestions for optimal media health. So they have a 9-hour pyramid, and at the top of the pyramid we have 1 hour of gaming. And then the next level down, we have 1.25 hours of social networking on sites like Facebook or MySpace, 0.75 hours for Twitter, and then the next level down, 2.5 hours for news. They suggest 1 hour on aggregators and blogs, and then 1.5 hours with traditional media like the New York Times or Wall Street Journal or Wired, and then 3.5 hours for entertainment. They suggest 1 hour for podcasts, 1 hour for online videos like Hulu and YouTube, and 1.5 hours for TV, and they say DVR/TV. So there's 9 hours that Wired Magazine suggests in front of a screen, you know, doing some sort of digital entertainment or infotainment of some kind. What they don't mention is that most people aren't independently wealthy and also have to do about 10 hours worth of work in front of a computer screen for their corporate employer. So there's 19 hours a day in front of the screen for somebody with a well-balanced media diet, according to Wired Magazine.
Thank you.
You just heard this week's conversational montage where I take podcasts and other internet media that I've listened to or seen over the last week and cut it up and rearrange it. The music in the background was a nocturne for piano number 5, the composer Frederick Chopin, and I found that on opsound.org. The pianist, a dedicated amateur, according to his entry note, was Paul Cantrell. There was also some music there at the beginning from Carrie Burt's short documentary film Mind Control Made Easy, and of course, a short excerpt from that film. I found it on Jerry Lentz's Facebook this week, and you heard a clip from Jerry Lentz's podcast, along with clips from Camo's Sea Realm podcast, Aeolus Cephas's Warty Theorems, George Kinney's Electric Politics, and the Alan Watts podcast. As you can tell, I usually get in my 19 hours at the computer every day. The music at the beginning of the program, and the music you're hearing now, is also from opsound.org, and the artist is Zeotropia. The piece you're hearing is called Busy Strings. Under Ben Burgis' short story, Sing, Goddess, Sing Me to the Stars, you heard Chris Isto White and Jerjli Kiss perform Isto's composition 826, which you can find on YouTube. Chris White is a tremendous talent, and he was very kind in giving me permission to play his music on the podcast, and I'm taking full advantage of that. Pete Seeger and Eric Idle did not give me permission this week to play their music, but I couldn't resist playing Oh Susanna and the Philosopher's Song. That was a Monty Python song there. As Steve Jobs said to Paul McCartney, so sue me. In other news, nobody won the Gita board contest. So, who is it that circles in the night and is consumed by fire? Well, it's the moths, of course. Moths circle in the night, and when they run into a flame, they are consumed by fire. Also, along with a lack of entries for that contest, I did not receive any donations. I don't know how you expect me to quit my day job and dedicate myself full-time entertaining and enlightening you, the listener, if you don't donate. So you can go to dietsoap.podomatic.com and find the PayPal link. Anything and everything is appreciated, of course. Next week, the podcast will feature an interview with the psycho-spiritual explorer and author Richard Grossinger, and I have several more interviews planned for the weeks to come. But before I play the out music here, let's listen to this week's Titanic factoid from my wife, Miriam.
So last week I talked about how the ship was put together, at least very briefly. And so this week I thought I would follow up with what it was that most likely caused the ship to fail after it hit the iceberg. So when lookouts Fleet and Lee saw that the Titanic was heading straight for an iceberg, they immediately informed the bridge. First Officer William Murdoch ordered hard a starboard, which means turn left, but such a huge ship can't turn left fast enough, and the ship hit the iceberg along the starboard bow. About 6 compartments quickly filled with water, and the ship sank in a little over 2 hours. That such a huge ship could sink so quickly led people to conclude that a huge gash, roughly 300 feet long, must have been made along the hull. And one theory was that the very cold temperatures of the water caused the steel to become brittle so that it would break very easily. However, this is not actually consistent with the testimony of the men who were working in the boiler room at the time. I wanted to read this short piece of testimony with the lead fireman, Frederick Barrett, and this is one of the hearings. So he is being interviewed by a Mr. Roche. Mr. Roche says, "You cannot say how much water was coming through at all." Barrett, "No, the commissioner. I do not understand this. Was a teacup full of water coming through? Barrett. No. The commissioner. What was it? Barrett. A continual pour of water. The commissioner. Now, describe the pour of water. It was not like Niagara Falls, I suppose, but try and tell me what it was like. Barrett. Just the very same as an ordinary fire hose would come in. So, there it is. So Barrett and others indicated that they didn't see a huge gash. It just seemed that the ship was leaking. And when the wreck was actually found, the theories about the big gash and the brittle steel were disproven. Rather, the observation was made that the damage was only about 12 square feet and that the rivets popped along the seams of the steel plating and thereby letting in the water. The rivets that the Titanic was held together with were made of wrought iron, which is mixed with slag. And slag is this glass-like material that is mixed with into wrought iron to help strengthen the steel. But in the rivets of the Titanic, many of the rivets didn't have the slag evenly mixed in and flowing along the lines that it was supposed to. So there would be these clumps of slag, which made the rivets not as strong as they should have been, and the heads would pop off pretty easily under strain. And that led to an unzipping effect as the load was transferred along the seam, and the rivets would pop. So, if you're interested in the science of the materials of the Titanic, there's a pretty good book called What Really Sank the Titanic by Jennifer Hooper McCarty and Tim Feck that you could look up to find out more about all of the science and lots of details, many of which I don't understand. But there it is, the Titanic factoid of the week.